Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So as we heard a few minutes ago, we're so fortunate to have with us today His Holiness Gopal Krishna Maharaj. And I promise Maharaj, I'll just give a brief introduction because sometimes when I introduce him, I go on for a long time. We're very fortunate. Maharaj is one of the very early disciples of Srila Prabhupada. He's been a member of our society for all but 2 years of its existence. So if ISKCON is now turning 50 years old, 48 years of those 50 years, His Holiness Gopal Krishna Maharaj has been a very, very active member. And Srila Prabhupada saw in him very early in their relationship, his leadership qualities and his leadership capabilities. And so from a very early age, he was given immense responsibilities, both for publishing his books and for organizing his movement in various parts of the world. And Gopal Krishna Maharaj has responsibilities for publishing all of Srila Prabhupada's books in India. He also oversees our activities in places, many parts of India, but including major cities such as Mumbai and Delhi. He just spent time in Russia, where he also oversees a lot of the activities, which is, if you know Russia, there's 10 time zones in Russia. So it's a huge country. And he's also had responsibilities in America, in Canada, in Africa, pretty much you name the part of the world. In different times, Srila Prabhupada has asked him to do different services. So we're very fortunate too that every year somehow he finds a time from his busy schedule to visit us here in ISKCON of DC. And so please give a warm welcome to His Holiness Gopal Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
First, I want to apologize for being late. I was aware that the lecture starts at 1 o'clock, but I just couldn't make it. I have a real bad throat and a heavy cough. So I'm very happy to be here, and it's a pleasure to be here in Potomac. Very beautiful temple, nice devotees, very beautiful deities. And Prabhupada personally visited Potomac twice. Once. In 76, and Prabhupada had a great desire that a beautiful temple be constructed here. So I'm sorry for being a little late, so I'll skip the kirtan, and we'll go straight to the voice from the Bhagavata. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Yeah, I'm very fortunate that there's a nice temple in Potomac. And by Prabhupada's mercy, there are virtually ISKCON temples in every corner of the globe. Does anyone know how many ISKCON temples there are around the world? There are more than 600 temples around the world. We're close to 650 temples around the world. But these are just temples. In addition, you have community of devotees in virtually every corner of the globe. I had a businessman from India who was exporting some items to a company in Sweden. And the company was located in a small town of Sweden. So he told me, in that small town when he met 8 Hare Krishna devotees in a small town in Sweden. So there are virtually ISKCON devotees in every corner of the globe. And in every corner, people are attracted to Krishna consciousness. Because Srila Prabhupada gave us the pure message. So today, I'm going to read to you a verse from the third canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is from chapter 29, on the third chapter, and the text is 18. I was a little hesitant upon reading this sloka and purport in a Sunday program, but then I figured most of the devotees that come to our temples are interested in devotional service, all right? How many of you have a great interest in devotional service? Almost everyone. How many of you are interested in going back to Godhead? And how many of you would like to stay on in America in the next one? So, this, since I don't have a very good throat, I'm going to request Gopal Hari, who is an assistant professor in foreigners, to read the translation in Prabhupada. Okay? It's a very sweet verse. Actually, every verse of the Bhagavatam is sweet. It's like sugar cane. Sugar cane you bite in the bottom or the middle or the end, it remains sweet. So Srimad Bhagavatam, compiled by Vyasadeva, has 18,000 verses. And every verse is sweet. But some are sweeter than others. And this is one of those sweeter than other verses. Okay. Read. Is the version on the board? Is it on the screen?
Yes.
Oh, here it is. Oh, this is a translation. Go ahead. Yeah. Go fast.
Adhyatmikanushavanan Nama Sankirtanachame Arjavinarya Sangena Viraham Kriyaya Tatha. Translation. A devotee should always try to hear about spiritual matters and should always utilize his time in chanting the holy name of the Lord. His behavior should always be straightforward and simple, and although he is not envious but friendly to everyone, he should avoid the company of persons who are not spiritually advanced. In order to advance in spiritual understanding, one has to hear from the authentic sources about spiritual knowledge. One can understand the reality of spiritual life by following strict regulated principles and by controlling the senses. To have control, it is necessary that one be non-violent and truthful, refrain from stealing, abstain from sex life, and possess only that which is absolutely necessary for keeping the body and soul together. One should not eat more than necessary. He should not collect more paraphernalia than necessary. He should not talk unnecessarily with common men. And he should not follow the rules and regulations without purpose. He should follow the rules and regulations so that he may actually make advancement. There are 18 qualifications mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita, among which is simplicity. One should be without pride. One should not demand unnecessary respect from others. And one should be non-violent. Amanitvam adhambitvam ahimsa. One should be very tolerant and simple. One should accept the spiritual master and one should control the senses. These are mentioned here and in the Bhagavad Gita as well. One should hear from authentic sources how to advance in spiritual life. Such instructions should be taken from the Acharya and should be assimilated. It is especially mentioned here, Nama Sankirtanacha. One should chant the holy name of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, either individually or with others. Lord Chaitanya has given special stress to the chanting of these holy names of the Lord as a basic principle of spiritual advancement. Another word used here is Arjavena, meaning without diplomacy. A devotee should not make plans out of self-interest. Of course, preachers sometimes have to make some plans to execute the mission of the Lord under proper guidance. But regarding personal self-interest, a devotee should always be without diplomacy, and he should avoid the company of persons who are not advancing in spiritual life. Another word is Arya. Aryans are persons who are advancing in knowledge of Krishna consciousness, as well as material prosperity. The difference between the Aryan and the non-Aryan, the Sura and Asura, is in their standards of spiritual advancement. Association with persons who are not spiritually advanced is forbidden. Lord Chaitanya advised, Asat Sangha Tyaga. One should avoid persons who are attached to the temporary. Asat is one who is too materially attached, who is not a devotee of the Lord, and who is too attached to women or enjoyable material things. Such a person, according to Vaishnava philosophy, is a person non-grata. A devotee should not be proud of his acquisitions. The symptoms of a devotee are meekness and humility, as Kaviraj Goswami and all the other Vaishnavas have taught us by personal example. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught us that one should be humbler than the grass on the street and more tolerant than the tree. One should not be proud or falsely puffed up. In this way, one will surely advance in spiritual life.
You want to repeat the translation?
Yes.
Okay. Is this verse too spiritual for the audience? If it's too spiritual, we'll take a lighter verse. Our experience is that those who come to the ISKCON temples, not only in Washington, but around the world, even in India, are those who have interest in bhakti yoga. There are many temples in every city of the world. At one time, when ISKCON was established, there were virtually no temples in North America, very few. But now there are many in every city of the world. And our experience is that those who want to take to the path of bhakti yoga go to ISKCON. And those who want just with any temple as a formality, they go elsewhere. So all of you are here because you have interest in bhakti yoga. And Srila Prabhupada presented the teachings of the Vedas without any adulteration. As most of you know, Prabhupada's presentation of Bhagavad Gita is called As It Is. So Prabhupada explains in the introduction why he called it As It Is. Because he presented the meaning message without any distortion. So if you want to take advantage of the Vedic message, we should receive it without distortion. So the Srimad Bhagavatam presents the ripened fruit of Vedic knowledge. Vyasadeva, the author of the Vedas, had compiled this vast Vedic literature. The Vedic literature is so vast that if you were to read it day and night, by the time you leave this body, you would end up reading only a fraction. So Vyasadeva compiled this vast Vedic literature, but he was still feeling as if some vacuum left in his effort. Something is lacking. And as he was meditating on what the cause could be, did appear the great sage? Narada Muni described as a Saptavakshavata. And he always ends up at the right time in the right place. Narada Muni explained to him, the real cause was he had not exclusively presented the science of devotional service. And then he gave it the Srimad Bhagavatam, which has 18,000 verses in 12 cantos. And from beginning to end, the purport is the same. Unless we take a pure devotional service, we can't be satisfied. How many of you have the Srimad Bhagavatam said at home? Okay. And all of you know, the Bhagavatam is available in a set form. So in the Srimad Bhagavatam, you get instructions as to how to perfect one's life. For example, in the seventh canto, we read about the instructions of the great sage, the Lord Maharaj. the Prahlad Maharaj had a great fortune of having received spiritual knowledge when he was in the womb of his mother. And Prahlad Maharaj told his classmate, Kamara Achat Pragya. Start cultivating spiritual knowledge from a young age. Age of 5. Why? Durlabha Manasi Janma. The human life is very rare. How many of us realize that human life is rare? Of course, those of you who are connected to ISKCON probably hear it in every lecture, how human life is very rare. And unfortunately, this knowledge is not being delivered in schools and colleges around the world, even in India. Prabhupada was once lecturing at a prominent university in America, and he asked the audience, is there any department that tells you what happens after death? And there's complete silence. So Prahlad Maharaj explains that one should cultivate spiritual knowledge from the age of 5 onwards, because human life is very, very rare. So in this third canto, the verse we are reading from is from a chapter entitled Explanation of Devotional Service. And this explanation is being offered by whom? Lord Kapila Dev. And who is Kapila Dev? Kapila Dev is an incarnation of the Lord. Avatar, you heard the word avatar? He had to thank a famous Hollywood producer who made a movie called Avatar, you know that? They spent $250 million on that movie. They earned a lot more. Nothing to worry. The movie was called Avatar. But from those who've seen the movie, I didn't see it. Well, from those who've seen the movie, they say, there's no connection with Krishna. But the saving grace was, he gave a very nice title, Avatar, which is a Vedic word, which means one who descends from the spiritual world. So these days, many claim they are avatars. If you go to any holy city in India, you'll find so many avatars. But avatar means one who descends from the spiritual world. And the list of the principal avatars is there in the scriptures. So Kapila Dev, he has explained to us the process of devotional service. He has explained to us, the process of Sankhya Yoga. And he explained it to his mother, Devahuti. Earlier in the Bhagavatam, Devahuti said, you are my transcendental I. You can remove my illusion. That's like sunlight destroys darkness. There's a verse in the Chaitanya Charitamrita as followed. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Adhikara Jahan Krishna Taini Maya Adhikara. Where there is sunshine, there's no darkness. Just like right now. Sunshine, what's the temperature? Okay, and a bright sunshine. Everyone's out on the beach. And the devotees at the Potamic Temple. Anyway, but the devotees take advantage of this nice weather, isn't it? People look forward to nice weather, when most of the time the weather is not good. And they go to the beaches. But those are devotees of the Lord, say, oh, nice weather, great! I'm going to go to the temple. Glorify the Lord. Hear about the Lord. So that's what devotees do. So, sunshine destroys darkness. So similarly, if you're Krishna consciousness, you can destroy illusion. So Devahuti was enlightened. She didn't need any guidance. But she knew that there will be devotees in the Washington area and other parts of the world that will need enlightenment, isn't it? Do we need enlightenment or not? Are we self-realized? opinion language. So you see that the devotees are asking questions. Like the other day, we were reading to you from the seventh canto about idol family life. And Yudhishthira was asking questions from Narada Muni. I said, how can one in the house of the ashram attain perfection based on Vedic principles? So it's the nature of the devotees of the Lord to always inquire when they meet a saintly person. Normally, when we meet a saintly person, or when we meet someone, we ask for blessings, isn't it? We meet people all the time, they say, Swamiji, please give blessing. And we, then when we ask them, what do you want blessings for? Spiritual life? No, something else. Only when it boils down to, prosperity. But those who are intelligent, they say, even if we get prosperity, it's going to be there temporarily, all right? Let's say you become as rich as Bill Gates. I hope no one of you are competing with him. But let's say you do manage to become that rich. Is that richness going to stay on permanently? Ultimately, everything gets separated except what you do in service to the Lord. So that is real wealth. The wealth that you see in society, the people are hankering after nice houses in Potomac, bank balance, etc. That's not the real wealth. You know, a few years ago, the Coca-Cola company, you heard of Coca-Cola? Yeah. It's part of American culture. If you haven't heard of Coca-Cola, you know, in America. Okay, they had an advertising campaign, and the theme was the real thing. What they were trying to convince the world was what? The real product is Coca-Cola. Everything else is fake. So our presentation is, the real wealth of the real thing is Krishna consciousness. That's the only thing that stays on with us permanently. So Kapila Dev here, in response to his mother's inquiry, is giving us some practical guidance. We should not think that this advice is too utopian, mythology, it cannot be realized. Sometimes what happens when you read the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, we feel, some of us feel, this is too theoretical, and practically it's not possible. It is possible. As you probably know, Prabhupada translated nearly 80 books in the English language. And these books have been further translated in almost every major language of the world. Today you have the Srimad Bhagavatam that we're reading from, available in Chinese, Russian, Arabic, Iranian, Urdu, which is in every language of the world. As people all over the world are reading these books. Why? Because they are being bribed. Sometimes people say, why don't you give away free books? People would have to give away free if people could afford it. But people are reading these books because they're getting satisfaction. When they read the pure message of devotional service, they feel satisfied. Because this is what we're looking for. And many of them are reading the books, get inspired to spiritual life. So we should not think that this philosophy is outdated or irrelevant in today's modern world. It is as relevant today as it was 5,000 years ago, and as it will be 5,000 years down the road. So we should accept the advice with full faith. So what's the advice? So devotee wanted to know, how can people achieve perfection? she told her son, he described the path of Samkhya Yoga. But now I want to hear about devotional service. The world is full of calamities. Is that true or false? How many of you think the world is full of calamities? Okay. These calamities take on how many various forms. But have you ever seen or heard of a giant taking birth smiling? There are a few doctors around here. Old age. Does anyone like old age? No. You know, some people like it. The medical profession likes it. There are people that get old, they'll be out of business. The pharmaceutical manufacturers like it. By and large, people don't like it. Disease. Does anyone like getting disease? No. No, but some people do. Anyway. We won't embarrass anyone. And then there are calamities caused by the mind, other entities in material nature. So basically, as Krishna says, the kalayam ashashatam, there's nothing but misery and everything is temporary. So Devahuti wanted to know, how can one free himself from these calamities? And she also wanted to know the role of time. Time is something very important. Krishna says, time I am that destroys everything, am I right? You may have a very handsome, beautiful body today. You may have been crowned Miss World. But are you going to remain beautiful and youthful permanently? No. I will make sure your beautiful body becomes ugly over time. Your melodious voice becomes hoarse. Time ultimately destroys everything. So Devahuti wanted to know how, whatever, she wanted explanation on devotional service. So here Kapila Dev is giving us some practical advice. There's a very detailed explanation of the verse in the purport, but we won't have time to cover it at great length because this is a subject matter for many lectures. So what does Kapila Dev say? A devotee should always try to be here about spiritual matters and utilize his time in hearing about the glories of the Lord. Hearing plays a very important role in our spiritual endeavor. We were talking earlier about Prahlad Maharaj, who was self-realized, who received transcendental knowledge, and he was in the womb of his mother. So Prahlad's father questioned him once. Prahlad's father could never comprehend where is Prahlad getting all this transcendental knowledge from. He would accuse Prahlad's teachers, whose names were? Sandana Marga. You're not doing your job properly. It appears that this Vaishnava are coming in disguise and brainwashing my son. And they would say, sir, we are Brahmanas. Don't accuse us falsely. We ourselves are Brahmanas. So Prahlad had of course received the knowledge when he was in the womb of his mother. So Prahlad's father asked him, made him sit on his lap, patted his hair and said, amongst the various subjects that you learned, what's the best subject matter that you've done with your teachers today? And Prahlad revealed, the ninefold process of the devotional service, it begins with? So if we want to pursue the spiritual life, what is being advised here is we should be attracted to hearing about spiritual subject matter. And if we are attracted to hearing about spiritual subject matters, then that helps us tremendously. Chanting and hearing, actually in the material world, everyone is hearing, isn't it? How many TV channels do you have in America? There's so many TV channels. There's some channels that broadcast only news 24 hours, like CNN. And people are glued to it. They want to know what's happening around the world. So there are many subject matters we're hearing. So we are not proposing that you stop hearing everything else except Krishna. No. But start hearing about what? Spiritual subject matters also. Start hearing about, as the Bhagavad Gita is saying, about spiritual themes, spiritual matters. The word used in this translation is spiritual matter, spiritual subject matter. Who is God? What's the purpose of human life? In the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, we get education into a real identity. Agita Charya, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has said, this is the most important of the entire Bhagavad Gita. Because in the second chapter, Krishna explains the nature of the soul, the nature of the body, how, like we discard our old clothes and wear new clothes, the soul leaves one body and takes on another body. That's a spiritual subject matter. Then we should discuss the role of time. How time destroys everything. Krishna also says in the Gita, time I am the destroyer of everything. It's your nature, how it works under the direction of the Lord. So what is being advised the Lord Kapila Deva is, start hearing about spiritual matters and utilize this time. We just mentioned about time a few times. Time is very important. There was a great devotee of the Lord called Chanakya Pandit. There was some India which was heard about him. Chanakya Pandit was the prime minister of a king. But a very renounced person. He would live in a hut. He was offered a palace to live in by the king. King said, you're so well, you man of such great wisdom. Please take this palace to live in. He said, no, sir, thank you, I don't want your palace. If I take your palace, I'll be obliged to say yes to what you say. I want to keep my independence. So Chanakya Pandit has given us great advice. So with regards to time, he said, a minute lost cannot be made up with the wealth of the entire world. You can have the wealth of the whole world and say, I want to buy back the 10 years I've wasted on the beach or whatever. You won't be able to do it. The time should be used like very cautiously in service of the Lord. So Kapila Deva is saying, start hearing our spiritual subject matters. I'm sure all of you sitting here do hear our spiritual subject matters. You'll come to the temple every Sunday. How many of you come to the temple every Sunday? About 40%. All of you should make it a point. You come to the temple every Sunday. You come and hear the lecture. Whoever is giving the lecture, you should hear it. You know, it's not that only some Swami is giving a lecture, we hear it. We shouldn't be ready to hear anyone who's talking about spiritual subject matter. So Kapila Deva is saying, hear about spiritual subject matter and utilize the time in chanting the holy names of the Lord. This point that we should utilize the time in chanting the names of the Lord gets repeated in almost every purport or most verses, am I right? If you were to read Prabhupada's purports, you would find that in most of the purports, somewhere or the other, Prabhupada does make the point that we should chant what? Chant the holy name. Parikshit Maharaj was the emperor of the world. was cursed to die in 7 days. And he prepared for his departure in a very magnanimous manner. The might of the great sages in question that, what should a person do if he's about to die? Is that question relevant to all of us? Or Washington being the capital, you have some exemptions. No special status for Washington. So everyone has to go through. So this question is very relevant. And Shukadeva Goswami advised here about the Supreme Lord Krishna. So chanting the holy name is a process that's recommended in this age for self-realization. So Parikshit Maharaj had questions, Shukadeva Goswami. How can people in Kali Yuga be safe from going to hell? And Shukadeva Goswami replied, Kali Yuga is the same. Kali Yuga is an ocean of vice. But there's one benediction in this age. That is the chanting of the holy name. So this chanting of the holy names of Krishna is a conclusion of the scriptures. This is not something the Bhaktivinoda Swami Prabhupada concocted or he invented. This is a conclusion in the scriptures. The chanting of the holy name. This is just one verse that we're reading. But if you read the Bhagavatam, you'll find so many verses, and as we said, in the purport, this point comes up again and again. The chanting the holy names of the Lord is highly recommended as a means of perfecting your life. And this point is being emphasized. What are some of the gains of chanting the holy name? Is there any benefit in chanting the holy name? For example, what? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, being the Supreme Lord, instructed his followers to write books on devotional service. But he himself left behind only 8 verses that we identify as the. But the beauty is, in these 8 verses, the meaning of the entire Vedic text is summarized. There's nothing that the Lord left out. So he explains in the very opening words of the Sikshasana, Chetadarpanmarjanam. One of the benefits of chanting the holy name is that the heart gets cleansed. Our hearts are clean or dirty. Prabhupada used to say, more black than a coal. You know how black the coal is. A heart of material. White, full of unlimited material desires. Lust, anger, greed, envy, hatred. And we all seem to think, if only I can get these desires fulfilled, then I'll be happy. But in material life, you can never really be satisfied. So one of the benefits of chanting the holy name is to cleanse your heart. You, just like a diseased man by taking medicine, cures him of himself of the disease. But this chanting of the holy name is of utmost importance. Rupa Goswami was a great devotee who was at one time serving a Mahamudan ruler called Hussein Shah. But his heart was not there. His heart was in serving the Lord. So ultimately, he was able to obtain release from his government service. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sent him to Vrindavan with a specific mandate to write books on devotional service. And the Lord had already instructed him on the path of devotional service in Prayag, to identify places where the Lord performed his pastime and to inspire the construction of temples. Sri Rupa Goswami gave us many wonderful books. The Prabhupada translated 2 of them. Which are those? Upadeshamrit and Bhakti. So in the Upadeshamrit, seventh verse, and it said, the holy names of the Lord are sweet like sugar candy. The passions of the Lord are sweet like sugar candy. But because our tongue is afflicted with the disease of avidya, which means ignorance, we can't appreciate the sweetness of the holy name. Just like sometimes you may get disease, you may have a high fever, and then even if someone gives you something very palatable to eat or drink, you can't experience the taste. Am I right? So that's exactly what happens to us. Because we are so deeply influenced by these material desires that we have, which are called anarthas, we can't appreciate the sweetness of the holy name. Then a question may be presented, we can't appreciate the sweetness of the holy name. Is there any hope for us? Is there hope or no hope? What's the hope? Rupa Goswami said, if we sincerely chant the holy name, then gradually the taste will develop. Just like by taking the medicine, the temperature comes down, and then you can appreciate the taste of the foodstuff you eat. So by chanting the holy name, the disease will get cured. So what is being encouraged here is, one should hear about spiritual subject matter. And now, as some of you may know, various ISKCON temples have classes that you can hear on the internet. So even if you can't come to the temple, you can hear on the internet about spiritual subject matter. Then it is said, the devotee's behavior should be straightforward and simple. Straightforward. If one is pursuing spiritual life, his behavior should not be duplicative. What does duplicative mean? You say one thing to A, one thing to B, one thing to C. Sri Prabhupada explains, straightforwardness that you should be so bold that you can speak the truth even in a difficult situation. And simple. Our philosophy is, by and large, simple living, high thinking. And an essential ingredient aspect of simplicity also is being straightforward. The devotee is straightforward in his dealings. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains the austerities of the tongue. You know the austerity of the tongue, he says, speak words that are truthful. Speak the truth, but in a pleasing manner, not in an insulting manner. And regularly recite Vedic literature. So, the devotee should be straightforward and simple. Our philosophy also is simple living and high thinking. If you live simply and think high, you will have time for spiritual activities. But what is the material philosophy? High living, simple thinking. Live as high as you can, beg, borrow, steal. Isn't it? And think simply. Thinking simply means think, where are the facilities for eating, sleeping, depending on marrying? And so, in the early days of the communism failed in most of the countries of the world, but at one time they had communism in Western Europe and so on, Eastern Europe. So their philosophy was simple living, simple thinking. They would live simply and think like the animal. Materialistic philosophy was high living, simple thinking. But spiritualist philosophy is simple living and high thinking means focusing on what should be the goal of life. Further it is said, a devotee should not be envious. Envy is an impediment. Sometimes we see someone has some abilities that we don't have. So we become envious. and we try to fall fine and pull them down. In simple English, they call it pulling back, and so on. If someone has some abilities that we don't have, we should be happy. Friendly to everyone. Sudha sarva dahino. A devotee is friendly to everyone. Even if somebody fault finds him, he's still friendly to him. A devotee doesn't believe in tooth for a tooth. In Russian they say zub a zub. A devotee is friendly to everyone. Sudha sarva dahino. And the devotee wants everyone to be happy. But he knows that if people want real happiness, they have to cultivate spiritual life. The devotee is not in any illusion that if I win a $1 billion lottery, I'm going to become happy. If we get a holy name, if we get spiritual association, if we get the opportunity to hear the books, then that is the source of real happiness. So a devotee should be friendly to everyone, and he should avoid the association of non-devotees. What this means is, I mean, in today's environment, there's no way you can avoid the association of non-devotees. Even if you want to preach, you're going to preach to non-devotees. So our goal should be to associate with spiritualists as much as we can. So if we associate the spiritualist, and that will help us advance spiritually. The community has given very valuable advice. The community has given very valuable advice. Prabhupada's purport is so detailed that if we were to discuss all the points, we would be here for another 5-6 days. You don't mind? I can see some people already lighting up over there. So anyway, I know we have limitation time. So Kapila is giving very good advice in this verse. So what are some of the main points? He says, hear about spiritual subject matters. How many of you think hearing about spiritual subject matters is important? All of you. See, I knew this was devotee's audience. Then what did he say? He says, utilize your time in chanting the names of the Lord. How many of you believe that chanting the holy name is most important? Almost everyone. Then what did he say? Be straightforward and simple. And be non-envious. Don't be envious. And then be friendly to everyone. And take advantage of devotee association, sadhu sangha. This is the theme of all our festivals, sadhu sangha. These festivals are designed to give everyone a chance to come and associate with saintly people. Hear the holy name, hear the philosophy. We are so deeply enriched, glued to our material life. The hearing once is not enough. Alright? Like you see in the material world, in America, the whole lead in advertising, Madison Avenue. You know Madison Avenue? No. You're not too American as yet. Madison Avenue is where the advertising industry of America is located. So they advertise the same product again and again and again and again. Why? To remind you this product is there. So we need to hear again and again. So Prabhupada labored hard and gave us this pure message of devotional service. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had predicted that the holy name would one day be chanted in every town and village of the world. And the great acharyas, headed by Thakur Bhaktivinoda, had this dream, had this desire to fulfill Lord Chaitanya's prediction. And Thakur Bhaktivinoda, he wrote a book on the life of Lord Chaitanya. then he sent the universities around the world. And Bhakti Siddhanta is his successor, endeavored to fulfill that order. And when Prabhupada met his spiritual master in 1921, in the very first meeting, Bhakti Siddhanta could see, here the educated young Indian. He told them, you're an educated young man, go and fulfill Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction, which was, the holy name will be chanted every continent in the world. So Prabhupada took this order to great to heart. And as we know, Prabhupada struggled. In India he had to really struggle. And he had to go, he didn't have any permanent residence even in India. And finally, he was able to succeed. Prabhupada's great vision was, he wanted to go to the West. And he decided, because India was under British rule for a long time, most Indians would first want to go to England. But Prabhupada said, no, I want to go to America. And then Prabhupada came to America, and his first city from New York, he went to Butler, Pennsylvania, because that was the residence of the host where he was staying. He was staying in the with a family called Agarwals, Gopal Agarwal and Sally Agarwal. He had an American wife. You know, Butler was a small town. A small town in those days, 66, 65, Indian smoke, sannyasi comes there. He becomes the talk of the town. So everyone was phoning Mrs. Agarwal, I think, who is that Indian Swami staying in your house? So she arranged a press conference for Prabhupada. She got a little tired, everybody phoning her all day. You know, who is this Indian Swami? So she arranged a press conference for Prabhupada. And in the press conference, in the next day, a newspaper called the Butler Eagle, there was an article that showed Prabhupada with the first canto of the Bhagavatam. Before coming to the West, Prabhupada published the Bhagavatam in 3 volumes. There was a college professor of a nearby town, I forget the town, that read that article. And he came to know that Prabhupada, the Sanskrit scholar, and he's there in the city of Butler. So he telephoned Mrs. Agarwal to inquire, can that Swami come and address our philosophy students? So she inquired from Prabhupada, Swamiji, are you ready to lecture to an American audience? That's what Prabhupada had gone to America for. He's not going to America to preach Indians, he's gone to America to preach the Americans. Prabhupada said, sure. Prabhupada was delighted. And you know what the name of the college was? If I'm not mistaken, Slippery Rock College. What, you get these names only in America. Slippery Rock College. Which the name would imply, if you stand there, you'll slip. Anyway, Prabhupada gave a lecture to the audience, which was primarily all American philosophy students. And then after the question lecture, Prabhupada would always say, any questions? So Prabhupada was so impressed by the questions that the American audience asked him, that he was convinced that America is a great place for preaching Krishna consciousness, and people are waiting for Krishna consciousness. So he at once packed his bags and came to New York. Even though he didn't have any residence facility, he just had some acquaintance with one Dr. Mishra. And after struggling for nearly a year, Prabhupada was finally established a legal society called the International Society for, when Prabhupada was organizing the legal work for the society, some people suggested call it International Society for God Consciousness. Prabhupada said, no, this is not specific. Krishna is specific. So on July 13, 1966, Prabhupada registered ISKCON. And as most of you may know, this year we are celebrating the golden jubilee of Prabhupada's registering ISKCON. Last year we celebrated the golden jubilee of Prabhupada sailing from India. This year we are celebrating golden jubilee of Prabhupada registering ISKCON as a society and opening the first temple in New York. So, around the world, we're having major celebrations for this occasion, Golden Jubilee, for a life, for a spiritual organization. It's a great achievement. And ISKCON is preaching in very difficult areas of the world. America is okay, India is okay. But there are many parts of the world where we have to face such great challenges. So many devotees that had to sacrifice their lives to preach in countries like Soviet Union and so on. So in spite of all these obstacles, devotees having full faith in Lord Chaitanya's desire and Prabhupada's desire have endeavored to spread Krishna consciousness. So we have these celebrations all over the world. As I said yesterday, on May 28th, we had a big program in Delhi, which was at the Tatotera Stadium, which was attended by 8,000 people. Last year, they had a major celebration in Calcutta, celebrating the Golden Jubilee of Jaladutta voyage, which was attended by nearly 30,000 people. And they broke some world records in that. They made it to the Guinness Book. Maybe all should also try and do something in the Guinness Book. So I believe that there's a big function planned here in Washington also. Actually, Washington being the world capital, you're going to have the biggest function. Am I right, Mataji?
Yes.
Now, being the world capital.
I'm talking 30,000, 40,000. A very important function.
And the Capitol Stadium.
Capitol Hilton Presidential Ballroom of the hotel right next to the White House.
Only two blocks from the White House. So if we do get them loudly, it'll probably reach the White House. So this is a big function. And I just want to request all of you to take part in this function. Because any function is successful only when all the devotees enthusiastically support it, isn't it? It's a good concept, but it needs all of you to get actively involved. Prabhupada says, in any effort you need four things. Some of you may have studied economics. Prabhupada says in the Gita, land, labor, what's the next one? Capital and organization. So if you want any effort to succeed, you need all these four ingredients. So it'd be nice if all of you can get involved in this. There are various schemes they have in which you can get involved. One is a platinum sponsorship scheme, which is for $10,000. Gold sponsorship level for $7,500. If you don't like gold, then there's silver for you. Silver sponsorship. And if you say, no, I don't like silver, it's too fancy. Then there's bronze sponsorship also. And so how many of you feel that we should do a very nice program in Washington? Really? Can we have a cameraman take a photo? So, are you ready to actually take part in this program? Yes. I will help also. But But if I don't help, then when the bills come, they'll send them to your house. All of you will help. Please help make this program a success, okay? Hare Krishna. Sorry, very little overtime.
Would you like to ask a question?
Okay, this time I will.
You could just have one or maybe two questions. It's a little late over time today, but especially.
There is Prashad,
anybody have a burning question they'd like to ask Maharaj?
One second. In your class, you mentioned about the chanting helps Chetodarpan Marjanam. So, chanting we are doing for spiritual advancement, and Chetodarpan actual heart is a material. So, how it is to understand that it is really going to help me in spiritual advancement?
So, because the greatest impediment to our spiritual involvement and advancement is the role of the anarthas. Because of these anarthas, we don't chant. We don't associate with devotees. Whereas, when the anarthas are cleansed, then it becomes easier to associate. It's like removing the dust from a mirror. If there's been dust in the mirror, and you stand in front of the mirror, you can't see yourself. But the dust is removed, then you can see how handsome you are. We need to remove the dust. Okay.
Other question?
Yes. Last question.
Inattentive chanting, does it accumulate sinful? I mean, does it accumulate more dust in our heart if our chanting is not attentive as per our standards?
It may not accumulate more dust, but it won't clean the dust also. Your goal is to clean the dust, isn't it? So thank you very much.